Good morning, my dear students. So today's class is on end-stage renal diseases. That is also called as chronic kidney diseases. This chronic kidney disease is nothing but is a spectrum of different pathophysiological processes associated with abnormal kidney function and a progressive decline in glomerular filtration rate. And it is defined according to the National Kidney Foundation as kidney damage of more than or equal to 3 months as defined by structural or functional abnormalities of the kidney with or without a decreased GFR manifested by either pathological abnormality or markers of kidney damage. Second point is GFR, that is glomerular filtration rate of less than 60 ml. Per minute for more than 3 months with or without kidney damage. For that normal glomerular filtration rate is around 90 to 120 ml per minute. If it is less than 60 ml per minute for more than 3 months, then it is defined as chronic kidney disease. So next comes to the risk factor. There are certain risk factors for which in whom these kidneys get affected and they go in an end stage or chronic kidney disease. The risk factors are such diabetes mellitus, hypertension, any of the autoimmune disorders, older age, family history of renal disease, a previous episode of acute renal failure, or structural abnormalities of the urinary tract. So comes to the causes of chronic kidney disease. In causes we have around 4 to 5 different types of causes which causes this chronic kidney disease or end stage kidney disease. In this most common or most commonly affected causes glomerular diseases. If there is any abnormality in the glomerulus. When we come to the histology of the kidney, we know the kidney histology is made up of glomerulus and ducts. That is PCT, DCT collecting ducts. So this glomerular disease causes are the first common causes to cause chronic kidney disease like glomerulonephritis, IgA nephritis, pyelonephritis. Then comes the systemic diseases like diabetes mellitus, hypertension, post-infectious glomerulonephritis or systemic lupus erythematosus. Then there are some hereditary disorders called as hereditary nephropathies. In this we have hereditary nephritis, polycystic kidney diseases. Then some of the vascular diseases, that is vascular is blood vessel abnormality can also lead to chronic kidney diseases like large vessel diseases, bilateral renal artery stenosis, small vessel diseases such as ischemic nephropathy and vasculitis. And then last causes are obstructive causes. If there is obstruction to the flow of the urine or anywhere in the urinary tract, it can lead to chronic kidney disease or end stage kidney diseases. The obstructive causes are like bilateral kidney stones, diseases of the prostate, urinary system tumors or vesicoureteral reflux. So just once again I'll brief you all the causes of chronic kidney disease, also called as a chronic renal failure. In vascular abnormalities, we have renal artery stenosis. In primary glomerular diseases, we have IgA nephropathy and glomerular nephritis. Secondary glomerular diseases, we have diabetes mellitus, SLE, rheumatoid arthritis, post-infectious GN neoplasia. Then we have tubulointerstitial disorder. That means tubes can also get affected by the drugs, infection, sarcoids or multiple myeloma. Then urinary tract obstructions. So the pathogenesis of chronic renal failure mainly depends on the two injuries. That is, one is a glomerular injury and another is a tubular injury. So glomerular injury, the pathogenesis is, it can be the injury to the glomerulus can occur due to any of the causes. Like injury can be immune mediated, obstruction and backward flow, growth factors mediated, free radical mediators or age related, all these things can lead to glomerular injury. Once there is injury to the glomerulus, there is increased permeability leading to proteinuria and edema. Direct injury to the glomerulus leads to hematuria, that is hematuria is blood in the urine, Decreased glomerular filtration rate leads to oliguria. Oliguria means less urine output. Then proliferation of the glomerulus leads to glomerulosclerosis. Glomerulosclerosis leads to hypertension, fibrosis, then ultimately the renal damage. So whenever the glomerulus get injured, ultimately the GFR gets reduced and the kidney function will be hampered. Then next comes the pathogenesis of tubular interstitial injury. The tubes and the interstitium in which the tubes are lying are affected by drugs, toxins and free radicals. It can be immune mediated, obstruction and backward flow, metabolic diseases, angiotensin II mediated or atherosclerotic mediated. All these things will cause injury to the tubular interstitium. Once the tubular interstitium get injured, it secretes more of hydrogen ions, leads to acidosis. Compensatory mechanism, angiotensin II leads to hypertension and edema. Calcium loss and potassium accumulates leads to renal osteodystrophies. Fibrosis leads to renal damage. Then comes to the classification of chronic kidney disease, that is CKD. It is classified into stage 0 to 5. Stage 0 is nothing but patient has a risk factor but glomerular filtration rate is more than 90 ml per minute. Normal it is 90 to 120 ml per minute. Kidney damage with normal GFR is a stage 1. Again GFR is more than 90. Stage 2 is kidney damage with mild decrease in GFR. 60 to 90 is a GFR. Stage 3 is moderate decrease in GFR, that is 30 to 50. Severe decrease in GFR is 4th stage, that is 15 to 30. Kidney failure, that is a total kidney failure when there is a less than 15 ml per minute of GFR. So stage 5 CKD is also called as chronic kidney disease. And it is synonymous with the now outdated terms like end stage renal disease, chronic kidney failure or chronic renal failure. Chronic renal failure applies to the process of continuous significantly irreversible reduction in the nephron number and typically corresponds to chronic kidney disease stages 3 and 5. The term represents a stage of CKD where the accumulation of toxins, fluids and electrolytes normally excreted with the kidney results in uremic syndrome. No more compensation, all other organ systems will end up with some kind of dysfunction. This syndrome leads to death unless the toxins are removed by renal replacement therapy using dialysis or kidney transplantation. So all the functions of the kidney will be hampered. Clinical manifestation. How a patient of this end stage renal failure presents? Failure of kidney to remove excess of fluid may cause edema of the legs, ankles, feet, face or hands. Shortness of breath due to extra fluid on the lungs may also be caused by anemia, hypertension and congestive heart failure. Metabolic changes in the form of an increase in serum creatinine or blood urea nitrogen can occur. High levels of urea in the blood which can result in vomiting and diarrhea which may lead to dehydration. Weight loss, nocturnal urination, azotemia and ultimately uremia. Uremia is nothing but collection of all the waste products in the body itself because kidney is not able to do its function properly. There is the excretion of waste is not happening. So the ultimately all these products accumulate in the body and leads to condition called as uremia. So proteinuria can occur and hyperphosphatemia. Hyperkalemia due to retention of the potassium. That is increased potassium is hyperkalemia may cause abnormal heart rhythm, metabolic acidosis due to accumulation of sulfates, phosphates and uric acids. Hematological abnormalities can also be seen in chronic kidney disorders like erythropoietin synthesis is decreased leading to anemia because kidney is the site where the hormone erythropoietin is secreted which leads to erythropoiesis, that is formation of RBCs. When there is no RBC formation, no erythropoietin, no RBC formation, patient will have anemia. And anemia symptoms are feeling tired or weak, memory problems, difficulty in concentrating, dizziness, low blood pressure. Then patient can also have cardiovascular problems, 50 to 65% of the deaths occur due to cardiac complications in CKD. Patient will have hypertension, left ventricular hypertrophy, electrolyte imbalances, and myocardial calcifications. So the trade-off hypothesis is, the patient has chronic renal failure, there is decrease in the calcium, increase in the phosphate, leads to increase in parathyroid hormone, then injury to the, because of increase in parathyroid hormone hypophosphatemia, there is injury to the bone, heart, blood cells and the nerve. So the definition of chronic kidney disease and the risk factors, the stages and how the patient presents, what are the signs and symptoms of chronic kidney disease. Then comes to the diagnosis, how we diagnose that patient is suffering from the chronic kidney disorder. So first is the urine test. In urine test we know urine analysis. In urine analysis we have a lot of dipsticks methods, urine albumin and creatinine, and 24-hour urine test. The urine may be analyzed for protein and waste products like urea, nitrogen and creatinine. Then finally GFR, that is glomerular filtration rate, as kidney disease progress GFR will fall. Only this, with the help of this GFR we can stage the kidney disease from stage 0 to stage 5. Then blood test, level of serum, urea and creatinine. If urea and creatinine are high, that means the kidney is going to damage, it's going for end stage renal disease. Electrolyte levels will be imbalanced, acid base balance, blood clots will be hampered, erythropoietin level will be decreased. Other tests can be done like abdominal ultrasound scan. Kidneys with CKD are usually smaller, that is less than 9 cm than the normal kidneys. We can either take renal biopsy to find out the exact cause for end stage renal disease. Abdominal CT scan can be prescribed, MRI of the kidneys can be done, or renal scan can be advised. So this is just a gross diagrammatic representation of the normal kidneys and a kidney in a chronic renal failure. The left hand side is a normal healthy functioning kidney having a proper size with low urinary protein, whereas right side is a kidney which the size is reduced and the surface is not smooth, it is granular, decreased function, small size and having high urinary protein, that is high proteinuria. So this is a microscopy of the picture of the CKD, that is chronic stage kidney disease. Here you can see there is one intact glomerulus is visible on the left hand side, upper left hand side, whereas in the center you can see few glomerulus are sclerosed. So these glomerulus are not at all functioning. So the reabsorption power of the kidney or the glomerulus is decreased. So the waste product formation is decreased. Since the patient will have oliguria or anuria, totally less formation of the urine, which will lead to uremia. So urine analysis, you see for the appearance, specific gravity, pH, protein, glucose, hemoglobin, urinary sediments and microscopy. So these are some microscopic pictures which will give us a hint that the patient may be going for chronic kidney disease. Like if you are seeing a lot of hyaline cast, a lot of RBCs cast, leukocytes cast, granular cast and the broad cast. Sometimes renal biopsy is also indicated in chronic kidney disease to find out exactly what is the cause for the renal failure. Whether the cause is glomerulus is affected, tubules are affected, or the problem is with the vascular, or there is obstruction. So we have two types of biopsies to take in the renal. This is the renal, gross appearance of renal. We can either put the needle and take the needle biopsy, or we can just cut out a part of the kidney and open biopsy can be done to see the cause. So this is the normal histology of the kidney shown with the glomerulus and the tubules. So role of renal biopsy in CRF is exactly to differentiate between acute from chronic kidney disease, to identify the cause of nephrotic syndrome, amyloidosis due to amyloidosis, multiple myeloma, diabetes mellitus, SLE, RPGN, or in renal transplant. Then comes to management. If a patient is diagnosed as an end stage renal disease or chronic renal disease, how to manage the patient, how to treat the patient? The goal of treatment is to preserve the renal function, to delay the need for dialysis or transplantation as long as feasible, to elevate extrarenal manifestation as much as possible, to improve the body chemistry values, to provide an optimal quality of life for the client and significant others. So first treatment is a pharmacological treatment. In pharmacological treatment, we give antihypertensive, cardiovascular agent, antiacids, metabolic acidosis. If it is anemia, we treat the anemia and control of blood glucose levels. Then medications, diet management, renal replacement therapy, dialysis and renal transplantation are the treatment of choice for chronic kidney diseases. So hemodialysis. Hemodialysis is nothing but hemo is blood, dialysis is filtration, blood filtration. It is removal of excessive water or excessive waste products, ultrafiltration. Then reversal of metabolic acidosis buffer system and removal of the waste products by diffusion is called as hemodialysis. So this is a dialysis machine. What we do, this machine will be connected to a patient who is having chronic kidney failure, who is not able to excrete the metabolic waste, whose urine formation is not is hampered, glomerular filtration is less than 15 ml per minute, so the urine is not at all formed. All the metabolic waste, excretory waste is accumulated in the body. So with the help of this machine, what we do, we connect the patient to the machine and we connect, this is a hemodialysis machine working pattern. The red thing what you are seeing is a patient side and the green thing what you are seeing is a machine. It's a hemodialysis machine where we have a hemodialysate or a membrane in which the patient's blood will pass through, and we use a vein. We usually we use internal jugular veins in the neck or in the antecubital veins. With the help of veins, the blood from the patient will enter into the machine, and this machine has a membrane and a dialysate where all the waste products like toxin passes through the membrane into the dialysate by diffusion. The blood becomes clean and the dialysate leaves dirty. So the clean blood once again it will be passed to the patient back by cleaning all the toxins. So this process is called as hemodialysis. Then hemodialysis uses a special filter called a dialyzer that functions as an artificial kidney. During treatment, blood travels through the tubes into the dialyzer, which filters out waste and extra fluids. Most hemodialysis patients go to dialysis 3 times per week. 3 forms of hemodialysis access device are there. One is called as atriovenous fistula. So what we do, we connect artery and veins to form a fistula. From there the blood is collected. Then arteriovenous graft and hemodialysis catheters. These are temporary access options. Hemodialysis access devices are the patient's lifeline and must be protected and monitored closely. So then one more type of dialysis we have apart from hemodialysis called as peritoneal dialysis, in which our peritoneal membrane, that is covering of the abnormal cavity, acts as a hemodialysate or membrane in which the toxin fluid from the body can be cleared and passed to the person. Peritoneal dialysis uses the peritoneal membrane as a filter to remove waste and excess fluid from the blood. The PD catheter is used for peritoneal dialysis to instill and remove the fluids. Then the kidney, in patients who are on dialysis, their kidneys can show some dialysis associated changes like loss of function and structural integrity, tubular atrophies, interstitial inflammation and fibrosis, arterial, arteriolar and glomerular sclerosis, amyloidosis, acquired renal cyst. Increased risk of primary renal and urinary tract cancers can also be seen in patients who are on dialysis. So these are some diagrammatic pictures of the kidney of the patient who is on continuous dialysis. Renal failure on long-term dialysis develops cystic changes in the kidney. Then the last modality of treatment for the patient who is having this chronic kidney disease is the renal transplantation. Renal transplantation is mainly this MHC complex or HLA matching. HLA compatibility is very, very important for any of the renal transplantation. This HLA is nothing but it's a complex, it's a protein present on the chromosome 6. So transplantation is nothing but removal or partial detachment of a part of the body and its implantation to the body of the same or individual person. And in transplantation, we have three types of transplantation. One is called as syngenic or isogenic, also called as old nomenclature is autograft, that is same individual, same species and genetically identical. Allogeneic transplantation is nothing but homograft, and is same species but not genetically identical. Xenograft is heterograft, where the species is different, totally different species, we can use the transplant or we can use the organ. So renal transplantation is a preferred treatment for patients with end stage renal disease. First we try conservative treatment. If it fails, end stage renal failure occurs, then we try dialysis. If dialysis also failed, then go for transplantation. If transplantation successful, patient will survive. If transplantation failure, the patient will definitely go for death. So indications for renal transplantation, again there are lot of indications, like parenchymal renal disease, glomerulonephritis, pyelonephritis, diabetes, hypertension, analgesic nephropathies, obstructive renal disease, congenital diseases, metabolic diseases and trauma or tumor related disorders. All these conditions can go for renal transplantation. So donor sources in renal transplantation, we have two types of donor. One is a living donor, living relative donor, other one is a cadaveric donor. So ideal conditions for the living donor should be age around 18 to 65, patient should be non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, non-cardiovascular patient, non-systemic diseases, mentally healthy, ABO blood and HLA compatible. Investigation of a potential transplant recipient, take full history and examination, do all his blood, hemogram, urea, creatinine, electrolytes, liver functions, bone, biochemistry analysis, tissue typing and some cytotoxic antibodies. In radiological examination, take his chest x-ray, skeletal survey, endoscopy, ECG and bacteriology. The transplantation process is, the transplant coordinator should be called early for any patient who may meet brain death criteria in the near future. Absolute contraindications for organ donation include if a donor is suffering from HIV, sepsis, non-CNS malignancy and severe cardiovascular disease, you have to reject the donor. Age, organ not harvested from patients more than 75 years of age. And complications of renal transplantation is surgical complications, early anuria and oliguria, acute tubular necrosis, rejections, others like infection, tumor, bleeding, hepatitis, diabetes, all these can occur post renal transplantation. Among these, rejection is the most common complication. Rejection means the transplanted kidney from the living donor or from the cadaveric donor will not withstand into the recipient body and it will reject it off. So this rejection is the most serious and most common complication of renal transplantation. Rejection is nothing but a process by which the immune system of the recipient of a transplant attack the transplant organ or tissue. Antigens responsible are of HLA system because of high polymorphism. Rejection is a complex process involving both cell mediated and antibodies plays a role. So end stage renal disease summary. End stage renal disease is nothing but involves a progressive irreversible destruction of both kidneys. This course discusses the consideration, treatments and procedures for end stage renal disease such as a hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis and renal or kidney transplantation. Thank you.